Alpha and the SCCA, they didn't want to make that race an opening race for sports cars. And at that time, there was no sedan class in racing any place in the United States. But there was a group of us in Southern California, headed up by a guy named W.R.C. Shedenhall, who was the editor of Sports Car International Magazine at that time, who were into racing sedans because it was the cheapest way you could go. You could go out, you'd buy an old Saab or a Cortina or a Mini or whatever, and I had this little funny car called the Hino. So we had about a group of about 35 of us out there. We'd go out and run these sedans out there. And it was really fun because it was pretty much wide open and very inexpensive. So anyway, the organizers for the Times Mirror Grand Prix decided that the opening event for the Times Mirror Grand Prix would be this little race for sedans. And so there's this huge crowd of people here, and all these Japanese top people from the factories and the marketing had come over. And I built a super cheater engine for the thing, just put the biggest arm on the crank I could find, bored it out as big as I could, and went out there, and I won the race. So when I pulled into Victory Circle, I mean, it's just this huge thing of people with cameras, and they're all Japanese taking pictures of me. I'm going, what is this? Anyway, you know, the next day, the headlines in Japan are, Hino wins Times Fair Grand Prix. And that really turned the corner. People began to look at what was going on in American cars. And I had, you know, there were guys coming up from all the factories offering me their business cards saying, you know, we'd very much like you to come to work for us and whatever. I'm super happy with the people that I'm working with. So I stayed with Hino and talked him into building some really trick cars. At any rate, make a long story short, Toyota decided they were going to take over, you know, in a kind of a hostile takeover. And part of the program that went with it was my going to Toyota and giving them all the technology and the GT car I designed for. At the same time, this is about 1966, Carroll had just won Le Mans and was at the peak of his career with the GT40s, and of course was a huge hero in the United States. And he went to his accountant, a guy named Barry Galloway, and said, you know, what are we going to do with all this money we've got here? And Ford's just decided they're going to quit racing. They've won Le Mans, and we've got the whole shop here. What are we going to do with it? Barry says, buy a Toyota dealership. So he said, okay, go down and buy one. You know, so he went down to 190th Street, went in there, and we went, set up a dealership for Toyotas in El Segundo for Mr. Shelby. So they were, of course, very pleased, and they said, well, in addition to that, we have the entire Gulf Coast, all the way from Florida, all the way over to Texas, available for the sale. It's a distributorship if you'd like to buy that as well. So Barry goes back to Carroll and said, hey, we can buy the whole distributorship, and they only want $250,000 for it. Carroll says, buy it. So now he's one of the largest Toyota guys, hasn't even got a dealership going. But I had just signed a contract with them to develop their 2000 GT race car. So when they went down there, Carroll had to go down there and sign the papers. Of course, he asked me, what's your interest in racing? And I said, well, we just signed a contract with Pete Brock. He said, oh, hell, you just got used to change tires for me. You don't want to go with him. You want to go with me. So, of course, they were super impressed because I'm nobody compared to Carroll at that time. So they decided they would switch the program. They didn't tell me about it. And gave the program to Carroll. And I didn't really find out of it. I'd gone into Hawk to upgrade my shop and borrowed a bunch of money to put in a dyno. And I'm all set waiting for the cars to come, and they don't show up. So finally, a friend of mine, of course, I hear from Shelby, calls up and says, you're not going to get the cars. I said, of course I am. I've got a signed contract right here. He said, no, the cars are here, and we're developing them. I said, no, that's not right. He said, yes, it is. So I realized what the game was. So I said, okay. So I went down cold to Nissan, walked in the door, didn't know anybody down there at all, and said, you know, who's in charge of racing or whatever you're doing? And long story short is they basically threw me out of there and said, we don't want to have anything to do with it, and go away. Okay. So I called up Mr. Miyako, who was my contact at the Hino factory in Japan, and they're going through a big problem with Toyota on the takeover of the company or anything. And he said, well, give me a couple of days. He said, I got an idea. And he called back 2 days later. He'd gone to lunch with a school friend of his who now happened to be the chairman of the board at Nissan Motor Corporation, and told him, so we've been working with Mr. Brock for 3 years. He's a straight guy. He's made our cars go really well. We're selling well. Unfortunately, Toyota's taken us over. He's your arch enemy. It'd be a good idea if you supported them. So, no contracts, nothing. They sent me 2 cars on an airplane, a bag of money, and we built the cars in secret and won the Pacific Coast Championship the first year running with the Roadsters. And at that point, then Nissan's fit management had to admit that it was okay to introduce me to Mr. Katayama, and from that on, I worked directly for Mr. Katayama. And they showed me the photographs of this new car they were coming out, called the 240Z, and I about fell over because it was a fabulously beautiful looking car. And so we made that into a race car, and we won the national championship seat production for 2 years running with that car. And you got to realize at that time, again, as I was saying, racing in the United States was just in this transitional into professional racing. So there was nothing like we have today. At that time, all the big money in racing was going into the SEC.